hello there and welcome to today's message from Lossie Baptist Church in Scotland. We really hope and pray that this is a blessing to you wherever or whenever you're listening to it.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, and welcome to this morning's worship service. We've come together this morning to worship our Heavenly Father, to give glory to the God who deserves it, to think of the things He's done, and to rejoice together as a church family. The psalmist writes in Psalm 95, "O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into His presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to Him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In His hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are His also. The sea is His, for He made it, and His hands formed the dry land. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hand." We've come this morning to worship the God who has created the heavens and the earth. And we think about how vast, how beautiful this morning is, how vast, how great the universe is. And yet God has chosen for us to be precious in His sight this morning. He knows who we are. He knows us by name, and He loves us, made us in His image. And so this morning, I think about that psalm, and it's easy for us, you know, just to stand in awe and wonder at who God is, that Jesus, who came despite our sin, has become our rock of salvation through His death on the cross. So this morning, as the psalm says, let us sing praises to the Lord. Let us sing and give thanks for His glory and His majesty. And we're going to do that together this morning as a church family. As we do that, let's just pray as we begin our time of worship. Heavenly Father, I do thank You for this psalm. Lord, help us this morning as we come to worship You to make a joyful noise with our singing and our worship. Lord, let us kneel down before the Maker and Redeemer. Lord, for You who have loved us, created us in Your image. And Heavenly Father, I thank You that every single person here this morning is significant to You, that every single person who comes to worship You matters. And Lord, help us to know Your presence amongst us as we look to worship You. Would You bless Paul and the worship team this morning as they would lead us in that time together? Would You, in our words, in our reading, in our time, in our thoughts and our minds, would You be glorified in all that we might be and do this morning? Would You bless us and be with us and speak to us as we would sing for You who deserves it all? In Your precious name we ask. Amen.
Please, will you stand to sing with us?
Water You turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind, so unlike You, not like I got
As you came in this morning, you would have received a bulletin, and so please read that. That has everything that's going on. If you want to know what's happening in the life of our fellowship, then it's all there in the bulletin for you to look through. I just want to highlight three things for you. First is this morning we have our church picnic together, which I'm very much looking forward to, right after this morning's service. So hopefully you've brought your packed lunch. There might be a mad rush to the co-op. Maybe after the service. If you haven't brought anything or you didn't know that it was on this morning or this afternoon, then there will be some sandwiches and things provided. So we'll make sure everybody is fed. Please just come along next door, especially if you're somebody that's relatively new to the church or you're wanting to get to know some people. This is a great opportunity to come and spend time as a fellowship with one another. Secondly is the Holiday Club, which is going to be the 1st to the 5th of July this year. and preparation is well underway for the circus coming to Lossiemouth. At the beginning of the week, there was about 40 kids signed up already, which we praise God for. And if you're interested in getting involved or serving as part of that holiday club team, then there's sign-up sheets just outside, or you can speak to Kate about that. And lastly, is SeaFest is coming up. SeaFest is the annual Lossiemouth Festival celebrating our fishing heritage. And so, as we often do, we'll have the tea tent this year. And so we're looking for volunteers for tray bakes, and also to come and serve the teas and coffees on the 6th of July to the community. Also, it'd be good, last year, I want to encourage you that we had really good conversations with people in the community as they came and spent a bit of time with us, and we spoke to them about the church. So if you have a gifting and wanting to speak to people about the Lord Jesus, then I encourage you to maybe sign up for the team as well and be there for SeaFest, and we'll try and use that opportunity just to spend time with the community. There's not a sign-up sheet for that just yet. There'll be one next week, but if you can tray bake, or you would like to serve teas and coffees, or you'd like to be there a part of that, then please let me know, and it would be great to have you on the team. On the 30th of June, we'll have the Songs of Praise service, so that'll be 3 o'clock, and we're all invited to that. There'll be no evening service on the 30th, and our worship team will be leading worship for that service, so please come along for that as well. Let's just spend some time in prayer for those who particularly need God's help at this time. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the joy that we have in our hearts because we know you. Heavenly Father, thank you that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And Heavenly Father, I pray that would be such a reality to us this morning as we would come into your presence. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would forgive us in our life, in areas and situations that we don't hand on to you. Thank you that life is precious in your sight, and I do want to pray this morning for our community in Lossiemouth. Thank you for the community in Lossie and beyond, people who are in contact with us throughout the week. And we want to pray for the coffee morning and for Little Acorns, for Kids Church, for YF, for the Scripture Union groups, for all the ministries as they meet this week. I pray, Lord, that you would encourage and strengthen, equip us, and give us encouragement to share the gospel with others around us, whether we be in our community, in our workplaces, our friends and family, Lord. Would you give us the words to say and the opportunities you'd give us? And I pray too for those who particularly need you at this time, Lord. We pray for Alec Campbell and his family. We pray for Murray as we had the funeral for Jean on Friday, their sister. We pray that they would find comfort in their grief because of their faith in who you are and what you have done for them. Pray too for Peter as well. We pray for Peter Butcher and for Leslie. We pray for Peter as he had chemo this week. And isn't feeling too well today, and ask that you would be with him in his recovery. We pray the same too for Rebecca. We ask for your protecting power over her, Lord. We ask that you would protect Joe and Sam and Ben as well. And Lord, too, I want to thank you for Dolly for her birthday this week as she turned 94. We give you thanks for the blessing she is to many in our community, for what she means to us as a fellowship, and we ask that you would draw near to her in this year ahead. We thank you for her ministry to the carers that come in on a daily basis, that desire that she has to share the gospel with them. And as she's watching even this morning, if someone is with her, Lord, would you just bless her and bless that time that she has with the carers around her. I want to give you thanks too for May and for Rachel Wilson as well. Lord, we give you thanks for what they mean to us as well. We pray for them. I'm sure as they watch throughout the week on the DVDs, ask that you would be with them and draw close to them. Would they know your presence as they watch from home, hoping to, longing to be a part of the fellowship like we are this morning. We ask that you'd draw close to them. And Lord, too, we want to pray for Rab as he would come and share your word with us later on. Lord, we thank you that you are the creator. We read in that psalm, the creator. You made the seas and the mountains, yet you have chosen in your grace to have a saving relationship with us. So Heavenly Father, I thank you that you're present with us today and you want to speak to us through your word. So would you encourage us and would you bless Rab? Would he be your servant today? And would he have the words to say that comes from you? Lord, thank you for our fellowship, for this time together. We pray for the picnic as well, that you would just bless that time together as a fellowship too. As we continue to worship you, Lord, would you draw near to us in your precious name. Amen. We're going to sing together two more songs, and on the fourth song, the children and the young people will go through for kids church, for junior church.
Okay, our next song is lifted directly out of Scripture, so I thought it might be worthwhile to actually just read through the portion of Scripture before we sing it. So would you stand with us this morning, and I'll read through this section, and then we'll go straight into the song. Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. And your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever."
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still waters. His goodness restores my soul, and I will trust. Yeah.
Good morning. Our reading today is taken from Matthew 5, and you'll find it on page 809 in the Bibles. The blue Bibles are in front of you under the pews, or the seats, rather, sorry. It's the Sermon on the Mount, followed, it's the Beatitudes. Seeing the crowd, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you, and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Amen.
Well, good morning. Let's respond to that wonderful reading. Thank you, Margot, in prayer together. Our Lord and gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you that it's sharper than any two-edged sword, that it never returns to us empty. We thank you for the public reading of it amongst us. And we just ask, Lord, we know this is an important sermon that you have taught many times. And we pray, Lord, that we would receive from you what it is you want to say to us. Open our hearts, open our minds. Thank you for your grace towards us. In your name, we give you thanks and praise. And in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, as we've read, we're beginning a new series over the summer looking at the Beatitudes. I am always really excited about what we're preaching on, which helps. But I'm really excited about the Beatitudes, particularly as we've been looking and preparing through this for us. It sounds really, it's the kind of thing that maybe even I was thinking if I myself have cliched them, maybe that's not quite true or quite true, but when we say things like, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted," it's something we often hear at funerals. And so sometimes for the Beatitudes, we can misunderstand them quite quickly. We can think that they're for certain people at certain times, maybe for people who are in poverty, for people who are mourning, for people who maybe are in a meek situation. But in actual fact, that's not what Jesus is teaching here. You can kind of see it if we look at how he opens and closes these blessings. If the last two blessings in Matthew 5 are the same eighth blessing, if not, there's nine blessings. But if we take it as the eighth, we see that there's a kind of sandwiching that Jesus gives in between these Beatitudes. Verse 3, if you look at it in your Bibles in front of you, and the one that we're focusing on this morning, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." Why? "For theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And then at verse 10, when we go down, it said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." So Jesus opens and he closes these blessings with a promise that they belong to the citizens of the kingdom of heaven. And so another way that we could maybe emphasize this to us is that those in the kingdom of heaven are poor in spirit. Always. And those who belong to the kingdom of heaven will be persecuted for righteousness' sake. They're not characteristics to earn the kingdom of heaven. They are the natural aspects of it. Let me quickly show you an example of this from Acts 5. And some of that's up in a slide for us as well, Brian. Thank you. You're on the ball. It says that when they, that is the Sanhedrin, had called the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And then the disciples left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name of Jesus. Amazingly, the apostles rejoiced not at getting a beating. They would have left sore and bruised after it, but they rejoiced because of their suffering was a sign of their blessedness in God's kingdom. And I'm sure they turned to one another when you think about it and quoted to each other, "Listen, guys, with your broken rib and your bruises, blessed are us who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And so the big question that we've got to kind of ask ourselves as we zoom out of this is, Jesus keeps talking about blessed are, blessed are, blessed are. What does it mean to be blessed? Or some translate it, happy. Jesus is describing something deeper than how we often use the words blessed or happy. William Barclay, in his commentary in this section, tells us how the Greeks used to use the same word for the Cyprus island. Cyprus' nickname was the Happy Island or the Blessed Isle. And it was called that because they viewed it as such a beautiful island that they said, you know, you'll never tire of the scenery in Cyprus. And it was such a fertile place that they said that you could grow all the crops you ever might need in Cyprus. And the weather was so good that we still go on holiday to this day to there, but the weather was so good, it was such a place they would say it's like a paradise. And so it's such a complete island, you'd never have to look anywhere else. And so when Jesus comes and he uses this word to say how blessed are those who have the kingdom, he's wanting to say to them how complete your life is when you discover this truth. How blessed, how happy, how fulfilled. You won't have to look anywhere else when you discover the blessedness that comes from God as being part of this kingdom. But where the Greeks looked at Cyprus and they pointed to all the good things, that's not quite the list that Jesus gives to us, is it? I've kind of put it into bullet points for us. You are on the ball today, Brian. Thank you. Well done. Poverty in spirit. Anyone interested? Mournful, meek, hungry and thirsty for righteousness, merciful, purity in heart, peacemakers, persecuted for righteousness, including insult and slander. Reality is that normally these are situations that rob us of our happiness. Jesus is saying these characteristics are a sign that you've received the blessed happiness. Where you find such a completeness and beauty, you won't need to go anywhere else. That's why the apostles, in being counted worthy to suffer dishonor for Jesus' name, could turn from that beating to happiness. Because these things don't interrupt God's blessing. They're a sign of it. So we know already, Jesus is teaching us about an incredible blessing. And let me tell you, there's something about this kingdom that's worthy of being explored and found out about because it's better than all the pain and suffering we face in the world. We know it's an incredible kingdom that God is inviting us into. And that actually leads us into our second point, introducing this teaching of Jesus, is introducing the teaching of the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. It's the same phrase that Jesus uses. We know it's an important teaching because Jesus talks so much about this kingdom. In chapter 4, we are told that Jesus, as he began to preach, began by saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Matthew 4:17. This expression, "at hand," was Jesus' way of telling us that it was close. It actually came. Jesus birthed it into existence with his life and his death and his resurrection. And yet it's at hand because it's still awaiting its full arrival, which you and I still await. In fact, we'll take it at communion, won't we, when we take the bread and the wine until he comes. Put simply for us, the kingdom of heaven is where God has his will and has his way. Remember in the next chapter, Matthew 6, we looked at this when we looked at the Lord's Prayer. Jesus taught them to pray. And he taught them to pray, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." God's kingdom is where we do his will, just as it is in heaven. And in contrast to this kingdom of God and this kingdom of heaven, there's another kingdom. And it's the other kingdom where God's will is not done on earth as it is in heaven. And there really are only two kingdoms. Last Sunday evening and tonight, as we're looking at the beginning of Ephesians 2, where Paul describes two kingdoms to the believers in Ephesus. One they lived in before they knew the gospel, and one they live in now through Jesus Christ. The old kingdom leaves the whole world dead in its sin. It's in step with the devil. And because it's the kingdom of disobedience, the sons of disobedience and disobedience to God. And then in contrast, Paul says, as we'll look at tonight, that we are God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Good works that God has made for us to walk in. You can see the contrast, a kingdom of disobedience opposed to God and a kingdom entered into, thanks to Christ, created for good works, that we would do them, that we would walk in them, that we would come in obedience to him. And the reality is that this is the great battle that takes place in each one of us. We are totally helpless without Christ. But in our new creation in Christ, we can do the things which God has for us. And so Jesus defines the first sign that you belong to the kingdom of heaven is that you recognize the danger of you. Jesus' first beatitude in verse 3 is, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." It comes first because it reflects the reality of becoming a Christian, a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. Here's what Jesus is saying. How happy and complete is the life of the person who realizes the poverty of themselves and the greatness of God. How happy and complete is the life of the person who realizes the poverty of themselves and the greatness of God. Jesus is opening by saying to us, do you realize how destructive your kingdom is, this other kingdom? The greatest hindrance to your spiritual growth is you. The greatest hindrance to my spiritual maturity is me. See, we want to think it's other people. We want to think it's circumstances. We want to think it's the way we were born, but it's none of those things. It's our unwillingness to experience a poverty in spirit. You know, I was reflecting on this myself, and I was thinking, how amazing, isn't it, that as we drive in the car, or we're walking the dog in the morning, or whatever it is, that we begin to tell and retell and tell again a story in our head, don't we? And every time we tell it to ourselves, we add a little bit of evidence that we think of, and we remove the parts that don't fit our forming narrative. Why is it, I say to myself, that I'm always the victim in my stories? I've never gone to someone and say, oh, let me tell you a story about what happened yesterday. It was completely my fault. I'm far more likely to come and say, let me tell you what so-and-so did yesterday. It's always the person we have an issue with that's the villain, and we're just the innocent one. I'll tell you why that happens. Because the greatest hindrance to your spiritual maturity is you. And the greatest hindrance to my spiritual growth is me. Nobody can make you more immature. No one can slow down your spiritual growth except you. The apostles received a physical beating for preaching the gospel. And where it was meant to discourage them from ever speaking about Jesus again, it actually encouraged them and gave them boldness. At the heart of this opening beatitude is the reality that we are at war between two kingdoms. Our old kingdom of disobedience, which wants to rule us once again, and the kingdom of God into which Christ has rescued us and brought us into that place of blessedness. For a moment, think about tensions that you find in your marriage, in your family, in your workplace, in your relationships. And what you find is that almost all of them become because people aren't serving your wants and desires. It's rare for us to have a righteous anger because people aren't serving the kingdom of God. How do we respond when people don't serve our selfish kingdom purposes? We respond with anger and frustration. We respond by withdrawing and sulking, by gossiping to others, and so on. These are the natural kingdom of disobedience behaviors that we turn to. You know, it's been years since I saw how immature I am. And I'm 7 months into marriage. And guess what? Oh my goodness. Like, you guys are right to pray for Rachel. Honestly, I'd never realized the level that I can sulk about things until I got married. And it's embarrassing. I have to go to Rachel and say, Rachel, I'm really sorry. Can I just be a child about this for a minute? Because I'm not happy I didn't get my own way. Well, a great book that we read actually together by Paul David Tripp on marriage, and it's great for all relationships, I think. I'm reading it for other purposes, although it's helping our marriage too. But the best book that we read, and it talks, its whole premise is two sinners brought together by grace. And it says in that, part of it is saying to us, that God loves us so much and he's so gracious to us that he's unwilling to leave us where we are. And he very often uses marriage to help us grow in maturity. And I'm early days, but I can testify to that truth. That I realize God is too gracious not to send someone like Rachel into my life, or not to send my friends into my life, or not to send even my work colleagues into my life, that they might rub against each other and discover areas in our own lives, not in their lives. That's the temptation, isn't it? You see, the problem at work is Jeff. Sorry if you're called Jeff. The problem of marriage is my spouse. But that's the kingdom of disobedience speaking. The kingdom of obedience comes and says, yeah, I need to work on me. God's kingdom looks like God having his way. It looks like mourning our sin, which causes pain to others. Liam will show us more of that next week. I'm away preaching in Hopeman. It's a kingdom that we're having humility and meekness instead of demanding recognition or position or privileges. It's a kingdom where we seek righteousness in every situation and response. It's a kingdom where we show mercy. It's a kingdom where we show mercy, especially when we have the upper hand. It's a kingdom that ensures the purity of our hearts and actions. It's a kingdom where we make peace, often by taking the first step to reconciliation without conditions. Let me read that again. In comparison to a kingdom of disobedience, this is what a kingdom of God looks like to us. The kingdom of God looks like God having his way. The kingdom of God looks like us mourning our own sin, which causes pain to others, especially God. The kingdom of God looks like having humility and meekness instead of demanding recognition, position, or privileges. The kingdom of God is seeking righteousness in every situation and response. The kingdom of God is showing mercy, especially when we have the upper hand. The kingdom of God is ensuring the purity of our hearts and actions. The kingdom of God is about making peace, often taking the first step to reconciliation without condition. Now, as I wrote that list and thought about it, I thought how great our church would be, our workplaces would be, our marriages would be, if we could live that kind of living. Can you imagine how that would build one another up instead of tearing each other down? But Jesus comes and says to us, such a living comes at such a cost. It comes at the very cost of being poverty or poor in spirit. When faced with this kingdom and what it looks like, if we're honest with ourselves, we realize we have no ability to live like this in our own strength. It just feels like losing. We don't want meekness to mean we're overlooked or missed. We don't want mercy to mean someone didn't recognize their fault. We don't want persecution to cause us pain, especially when it can be avoided just by keeping our heads down. You see, it's just unattractive to our own selfish kingdom desires. And that's why Jesus puts the poor in spirit as the first beatitude. To enter the kingdom of heaven, we have to realize how ugly and destructive the other kingdom is. The kingdom that's all about me instead of all about God. The kingdom is impossible to enter in our own strength, but what is impossible for us, praise God, is possible for him. And so Jesus sends out an invitation in this sermon. It begins his ministry. I'm sure he preaches it multiple times in his time of preaching throughout Israel and surrounding areas, Tyre and Sidon and so on as well. But right at the very beginning, Matthew records this sermon because right at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, he's putting out this invitation to empty ourselves of our own selfish desires, our own selfish ambitions, our own selfish demands, and instead come with empty hands, with a poverty in spirit, in order that we might receive God's strength to live in his desires, his ambitions, and his demands. And the truth is, that offer will only be attractive to you if you've received the gift of faith to see how beautiful God's will is, how blessed his kingdom is, how abundant your life can be when you let go of yourself. And we discover that letting go of ourselves doesn't lose our identity. We actually discover a greater self-identity gifted to us in Christ. Discovering that you're poor in spirit, discovering that you've got nothing in yourself, is actually the vital step to discovering all that God wants to gift to you. But you've got to get out of the way first. Jesus' chief concern in this sermon is about our view of ourselves. The greater our self-view, the more we'll oppose Jesus' invitation to receive the kingdom of heaven. Living for yourself is consuming. It pushes others away. It makes you behave in ways that you wish you didn't. It doesn't liberate you to love without reservation, or to move on when you've been hurt, or to rejoice in something greater than your circumstances. It sounds really good when we talk about live for yourself, find yourself, be true to yourself. Stuff I used to hear all the time when I was a chaplain in a primary school used to always say to them, you know, find yourself, discover yourself. You're amazing. You can be anything, anything you want to be. And I always just sat there thinking, no, you can't. That's not realistic. But I didn't say it out loud to the children to ruin their hopes of being an astronaut or whatever it might be. It can be someone else's job. Let the parents do that. But our world constantly says to us, live for yourself, find yourself, find your true self, be true to who you are. And in reality, that offer is a bitter, self-consuming lie to have to drink. And if you let go of your will being done, you'll be ready to taste the sweetness of God's kingdom life. Don't be true to yourself, be true to God. Don't find yourself, find Christ. Because what you'll find is what we find with these young people when we say you have to go and change the world. Good grief. The pressure on our young people's shoulders to change the world. No wonder they're gluing themselves to roads. Don't change the world. Change yourself. Change yourself by turning to Christ. Recognize his sovereignty. Recognize his rule. Recognize that his will be done. Recognize the liberation that you don't have to be a success story in the eyes of the world. You just have to be a success story in the eyes of Christ. And it becomes a success story in the eyes of Christ as you empty yourself and come to him. Oh, it's a better story. It's a greater story, but it's a painful story because poverty in spirit hurts and it's hard. And yet Jesus doesn't save it to the end for those that stick it out. He says it at the beginning. Before you begin, you need to hear, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they will have the kingdom of heaven. I want to finish by pointing to Christ, who, though he was God, didn't hold on to his divine power for his own advantage, but emptied himself by taking on humanity just like you and me, yet without sin. He made himself a servant to the very one who opposed his kingdom, you and me. He humbled himself in obedience to the Father to the point of death, even the humiliating death on a cross. And he did this to the glory of his Father in heaven, that through his birth and death, his servant life, his resurrection, he could live in the most selfless life, dying for our gain. The reality is that Jesus was not above emptying himself for your gain. He invites you not to think you're above yourself, emptying yourself to receive that gain that he's accomplished for you. We can receive it through that gift of faith, but the work of faith will make us realize how poor in spirit we are, how much we need to empty ourselves in order to let God be our fullness. For those who've got Bibles, and particularly blue Bibles, could you turn to one scripture that we'll finish on in 2 Corinthians? You'll find it on page 966 for those who are using the blue Bibles. I like it. Don't put it on the screen. Oh, no, it's on the screen. Fine. Don't worry. Sorry. I forgot I made a slide for it, Brian. Thank you. For those who don't want to look at the Bibles, but I like it when you look at your Bibles. It's a good thing for us. We do it quite a lot in the evening. 2 Corinthians 5. This is what it says in verses 14 and 15. The love of Christ controls us. Because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who might live no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. For the love of Christ controls us. That's Jesus' invitation. Be controlled by the love of Christ, because we've come to understand, we've concluded that Christ died for all, and therefore all have died who have faith in Christ. And as he died for all, that those who live may no longer live for themselves. What a burden that was. But we can be liberated to live for him who for our sake died and was raised. Tough sermon. Tough to hear, tough to preach. Invitation to that poverty of spirit. We're going to see it wonderfully, fit wonderfully with next week when we mourn, and it's the mourning of our sin as we have an awareness of just our own unworthiness before God. But as we see the strength of this kingdom, a kingdom that is full of God's character, of his humility, of his hunger and thirst for righteousness, of his mercy, of his purity in heart, the way that he made peace between us and God, we see our total inadequacy to be part of this kingdom. But through Jesus Christ, a way has been made through his death and resurrection, and he invites us. As Christ emptied himself for us, would we empty ourselves to gain what he's offering to us? A wonderful invitation. It's a wonderful sermon. And it's only going to get better as we expand it more and more over these next 7 or so weeks together. Let's pray together. Our Lord and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you over this summer for the opportunity to come to this Sermon on the Mount, and particularly to the Beatitudes, to see the blessedness that you announced as you brought in this kingdom which is at hand and one day will come in all its glory and wonder. And Lord, we recognize that the greatest opposition to your kingdom in our lives is ourselves. And we're sorry for that. We're sorry for the fleshiness which so easily takes our minds and our hearts. But Lord, I thank you that you knew all of that beforehand, that you understand exactly how far we were from you, absolutely unable to come to you in our own merit and our own ability, but yet still you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, into this world, and Jesus willingly gave up his life in our place that he might forgive our sins. We thank you for this great truth. And we ask as we come towards these Beatitudes, as we come to the beauty of them, As we come to a kingdom living, Lord, make us a people. Make me a minister who would hold on to that mourning of my sin and that meekness in my non-desire for status, but just for your glory. In my hunger and thirst for your righteousness. In my mercy. And make it true for us as a church. Lord, that the world would see us shining out as Jesus goes on to speak about salt having its saltiness and a light. Lord, that's our desire. Work this as it is a miracle in our lives. And help us to see that we must decrease in order for the wonder and glory and abundance of life that comes as you increase. And we ask it in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask it to your glory. And we ask it for the sake of the kingdom being built here in Lossiemouth. Lord, would you be famous? In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's just move into a time of worship as we move towards communion. Please would you stand with us?
Thank you.
we come to the communion table, we invite all those who know and love the Lord to come and participate with us, to come in obedience to God, in obedience to Jesus, who called us to come to this table in remembrance of him. As we see this kingdom lived out, one of the ways, and I included it without quoting it in my sermon, but in Philippians 2, Paul, in the same tone as this kingdom, wants us to see the significance of Christ. He says, "Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but to the interests of others. And have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. Being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that's above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." We see at this communion table Christ's willingness to empty himself for our sake. His willingness to not just take on human form, not just become a servant, but even take the pain of that separation between us and God on himself as he took the weight of our sins on his shoulder. He emptied himself so that we could gain. We're invited to come to this table with empty pockets and empty hands to recognize that all we receive is a gift wonderfully given by a faithful Christ who calls us to be poor in spirit, that we might enjoy the riches of his grace and mercy. We'll have the prayer for the bread and the wine.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we think about the cross. We think about the sacrifice made for us. Heavenly Father, your Son came to die so that we would have life that's abundant and eternal. And as you look at the wages of sin, we see in Scripture the wages of sin is death. But Lord God, you took and you take our sin seriously. And you take our brokenness seriously. And Heavenly Father, we thank you that by your mercy you chose to send your Son. We thank you for the Lord Jesus, for the perfect sacrifice that he is and was. Thank you for the sacrificial love that we see so evident on the cross as he was mocked and tortured, his body beaten, and his blood shed for us. Heavenly Father, help us as we come into your presence for this time of communion to take sin seriously, to take the trespasses of our own life with sincerity. And I pray, Lord, that you would remind us of your forgiveness, for the resurrection power. Lord, help us in this time of communion to focus on you, to focus on what you've done for us, and to give you praise and glory for the gift of eternal life that you've given in the promises to us. Amen.
Paul speaking to the church in Corinth says, "I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" We'll take the bread as we receive it as that reminder that Christ has met with each one of us, giving us the gift of faith. The same way he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We'll hold on to the cup and take it together as that reminder that Christ has also brought us together. As often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So we come to close our service on the words at the end of Hebrews. You're, of course, invited to stick around for tea and coffee together for fellowship, and please do stay around for our church picnic as well. Even if you don't have anything, please come with us. There's our sandwiches there for you. But let's finish on these words. "Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen." Thanks, George.
God of Jacob, great I am.
You have been listening to Lossiemouth Baptist Church. For more information, look at www.lossiebaptist.org.